It's been a while since I made any reviews. Tried doing Starship Troopers Invasion, but given how StarCraft draws on that universe, and I've been feeling pretty fatigued in StarCraft for a while, it didn't feel like a good time to do that. Then I tried doing 2001 Space Odyssey. Yeah. That wasn't a good idea to try. At least not yet. Dear God, the opening music to that movie has an interesting backstory. Thus Spoke Zarathustra by Richard Strauss, who is inspired to write the song by Friedrich Nietzsche's book, Thus Spoke Zarathustra, the famous book where Nietzsche said humanity had killed God and where the concept of the Übermensch was first thought up. Sure, I pulled a Ric Flair joke and some examples of how Space Odyssey inspired a lot of later fiction, but it just felt like something was missing from my attempt. So I'll leave that idea to continue to grow, assuming I ever go back to it. So, instead of a slow-paced work of art with a hell of a lot of backstory and thought behind absolutely every camera angle and piece of music, let's try reviewing something easier to get into. An old favorite that's been bouncing in my head ever since I started LP in the Ace Combat series. That's right, Swat. Just based on the music before the show even starts, you can already tell this is gonna be awesome. This is a mostly episodic show, and unlike MASH, it has only 23 episodes overall, so there is absolutely no way I'm going to avoid spoiling some details. Still, pretty much every episode is a standalone story, so even after I mention everything about the main characters' origins and personalities, it'll still be a pretty fun ride. Welcome to Megacat City, spelled with a K. I'm not gonna question why they constantly spell cat in this show with a K. When they're dealing with a world of anthropomorphic cats, you can let certain things slide. I don't recall ever seeing a map for this city. Never got the sense that it was part of a much larger country, which is strange, since there's at least one outright invading army, and I have to wonder about the somewhat disturbing police force with the somewhat intimidating name of Enforcers. It's issued so many tanks, helicopters, and fighter jets. The most insane part is the fact that the Enforcers are frequently overpowered by the numerous villains.
Blast that dark cat! Very well. Let's see what he can do against this. Dark cat will never be able to get three targets traveling faster than the speed of sound. Were the best pilots I had.
The SWAT cats have a surprisingly large and varied rogues gallery, and one of my personal favorites was actually a one-off villain who they had absolutely no intention of bringing back even if they could have continued the series. But first, let's talk about our heroes for a bit. Say hello to Chance Furlong and Jake Clausen. These guys used to be a pair of damn good enforcers, or at least it's implied they were. One day, they were chasing after a criminal named Dark Cat, who would probably fit in with the likes of Goldfinger and Dr. No, when the chief of the enforcers, Commander Ulysses Ferrell, wanted to make the final shot.
One more shot and Dark Cat is history!
This is Ferrell. Fall back, you two. I'll handle Dark Cat.
Negative, Commander Ferrell. We already have our missiles locked. It's our tag.
I'm ordering you to back off.
I repeat, sir, we've got a lock.
We're out of the game, Chance. We gotta eject.
Gone! All because of those two young hotshots!
Bloody hell! The bad guy gets away and Enforcer's headquarters is in need of severe remodeling. And several hundred gallons of water. And guess who gets stuck with the bill and exiled for it? That's right. The commander's ego won't let him admit that he was in the wrong. And these two were kicked off the force and sent to a damn junkyard to spend the rest of their 9 lives trying to pay off a debt they'll probably never be able to get rid of. And in one of the most surprisingly believable moments in all superhero origins, they decide to use that junkyard to become vigilantes, since they're very sure that Dark Cat will return and more villains will rise up. Thus were born T-Bone and Razor, the two cat squadron with enough toys for even Batman to take notice. The show never goes into any detail of how they got that F-14 fighter to work, or how they modified it and got so many varied missiles. And can someone tell me who their tailor is? Still, a well-done fanfic is out there with someone's idea of how they got everything rolling. Midnight Oil by Bandit Summer. Yes, I am honestly making fanfiction recommendations in this review. The show was criminally short, and a few of the fics I've run across are damn good. Hell, the entire fan community for Swat Cats is pretty awesome in itself. Anyway, back to the characters. T-Bone is the proud pilot of the pair, an ace who studies up on famous aces of the past, is a damn fine mechanic, and, well, as you can tell, this guy is a wall of muscles. Probably around 200 pounds or something. But while he's probably the better physical fighter of the two, it's very rare they face an enemy down that either of them can beat in a straight-up brawl. As a side note, he has a crush on the deputy mayor, who happens to go to their junkyard occasionally to get some possibly illegal modifications to her car. But we'll talk more about her later. As good as T-Bone is with a wrench, Razor is just better. Whenever the pair needs something new, this guy designs it, builds it from whatever is available, and somehow manages to fit it into their ground gear or put it into their plane. Wait. Was that a saw blade on a missile? And how the hell did he make sure that missile didn't accidentally crush their target? Sure, he's the guy who fires it and he's ridiculously accurate, but so many of his weapons are ridiculously circumstantial. I kinda wish I had more to say about these two, something more profound in all that. Unfortunately, that's all I've really got. It was, after all, a very short series, and we didn't get to see too much of them when they weren't on the job. What we do see tends to either never be mentioned again, or a small tidbit like what kind of humor they enjoy. May as well talk about the other constants in some more detail. First up, Commander Ferrell. Yeah, he's kind of an arrogant bastard, but he is a determined one, and he tends to lead from the front lines. His probably biggest flaw is his pride and how he never changes his tactics.
This is Ferrell. Bring me Chopper backup. Alive. They've taken over my choppers, and I'm going after them. This is Ferrell. I need chopper backup. Oh, this is Ferrell. Bring me more chopper backup.
Good God, man. Air support is not some magic gun that will solve all your problems. You need to be able to coordinate your people, not throw numbers at it and hope you'll win eventually. Especially when you're fighting Godzilla in the middle... Wait... The hell? On second thought, it probably wouldn't matter much who was in charge of the enforcers. This town is making Gotham City look tame. Next important character, Mayor Manxk. You'd think in a city with so many problems, you'd want somebody especially competent in charge. A Churchill to keep the people strong in hard times. Someone with the right priorities. Not this guy. I can't recall him ever doing any real mayoral work. He might pop up from time to cut a ribbon. But he's more likely to work on his golf game in the office. Some moments he's funny, some moments he actually has his head on his shoulders, and others, he pisses me off. The person you just saw him shove was his deputy mayor, Calico Briggs, better known as Callie. She is the real power in Megacat City, thank God, since she's the only one at the top who fully appreciates the SWAT cats. She's the one who gets things done, has plenty of guts, and for reasons never explained, she has a communications link with T-Bone and Razor. All in all, an awesome lady that I really wish we could have gotten to know a bit better.
When do you think I can pick up the car?
Jake will start on it right away. You can wait for it. How about some milk?
I really can't. I've got to get back into town and help His Honor write his speech for tomorrow's park dedication.
I'll be happy to drive you.
No need. Mayor Manxk is waiting for me outside. One of the perks of being deputy mayor. Thanks, Chance.
Did you hear that? She's crazy about me.
Bye, Jake.
Now for a small taste of the Rogues Gallery. First up is, of course, Dark Cat. This guy's goal is to destroy Megacat City and build a new one called Dark City where, and I quote, "Lawlessness is the law of the land." This guy has an army of little bat-like creatures called Creeplings. His origins and the origins of his little bastards are never explained in the show. But apparently, some of the promotional material for the show implies he's a city judge. Probably a low-profile judge. How else could he have a damn day job and not get caught? He's pretty distinctive-looking, even if you don't pay attention to his wardrobe.
It's about time you said hello, Commander. I imagine it's getting rather chilly in the cargo bay.
You're too late, Dark Cat. The enforcers are right behind me.
You're referring to the signal this communicator is sending, I assume? Well, let your men come. By the time they arrive, Megacat City will be in ruins. Welcome aboard the Doomsday Express, Commander. Enjoy the ride.
Next up is Dr. Viper, who reminds me of one of Spider-Man's villains, the Lizard Man. This guy was once a scientist named Elrod Purvis, and he's the victim of a formula he himself created. Though I'm curious why he decided to try stealing his own formula, especially before they were finished testing it. Sure, I get that he was greedy and didn't want to share the cash with the man who helped him create it, but at least wait until you reach the human... cat trials before you pull this sort of thing. Though he doesn't seem to mind his transformation. In fact, he wants to spread it around, turning the city into Mega Swamp City, a place filled with primal, vicious creatures under his control. Huh. Now that I think about it, it's a very easy pattern with a lot of these villains. On the bright side, this means they're very unlikely to work together.
Viper, wait! A little altercation has given me an idea. Instead of fighting each other, why don't we join forces against our real enemies?
You mean the SWAT cats?
Yes. With them gone, Mega Cat City will be ours for the taking. There'll be more than enough to go around.
Oh, you gotta be shitting me! And to continue with the whole take over the city theme, say hello to the Passmaster. This guy wants the world to be in an eternal dark ages. And by God, when a guy can open time vortexes, throwing dinosaurs at you, sending you into a potential dystopian future, wow! I don't think I've ever seen a villain quite like this little gnome before. Part of me thinks he could have used a few more spells in his repertoire other than generic energy beam, the occasional portal, and rising up a couple of weak skeletons, but he was always fun to see. Well, so long as you aren't likely to be caught in any of his plans anyway.
And your future looks bleak!
Now for the last of the major recurring villains, the Metallicats. Once they were gangsters named Mac and Molly Mange. They died escaping from the Alcatraz prison. The part of me always thought they wanted to die, if only to get away from that cringe-worthy joke. Ugh. Alcatraz. Some kind but foolish scientist who had no idea who these two were in life decided to save what was left of them, putting their minds into metal bodies. Yes, we have a pair of evil Robocops, only without the fleshy bits. And unlike the other recurring villains, these two seem more inclined to raise hell for the sheer sake of it, rather than some part of a master plan. Hell, they already died once. Why be cautious in the next when you're a Terminator?
We are just drowned, trying to bust out of Alcatraz.
Now watch what them voices. How come you guys sound so weird?
Not just our voices that have changed, Fango.
We had a complete makeover. What do you think?
I think you two should have stayed dead. It's my mom now. And you guys are history.
What a shocking development.
Shame there aren't any more characters who appear often and prominently enough for me to talk about them with any real length. Sure, you got some that had plenty of potential, and the ones I've already mentioned had plenty of room to grow. But that potential was never reached because the show was cancelled, and while I'd probably be one of the first people to jump at the chance to see this series revived and reimagined, nobody who can actually do it, seems to want to. Still, this show earned a damn good fan community. Fan sites linking to other fan sites, a wiki dedicated to the show that's updated daily, some well thought out fan fiction. Speaking of, after you've watched the show, I'd suggest reading up Swat Cat's Endgame by Kanto the Slayer. This explores the characters further, ties up plenty of loose ends, and is a damn fine tribute to the show. I'm a little tempted to give that a review, since it's got so much material that I'd be able to talk about it more at length, but, well, this is YouTube, so it's probably a better idea to review things that have some visuals. Oh, before I close the book on this, one fair warning. With this show's emphasis on action, the extreme number and variety of missiles the Turbo Cat can carry, even their damn ejector seats are armed to the teeth, and the fact that most of the threats are at least on a city-wide scale, if not larger, it's not as easy to watch several hours of it in one sitting. I'm not saying it's bad, just that its main strengths can feel a little repetitive at times. There's only so many ways you can deal with a massive monster assaulting the city, animating an aircraft dancing around enemy attacks and shooting missiles, and the SWAT cats themselves don't feel all that different when they fight anyone on foot. Give it a try, watch a few episodes, especially ones that involve the Metallicats. And if it's not your cup of tea, I understand. It's hard to make a grade A show when you got no plot to tie a season together. Anyway, that should be all for this review. I hope it was fun to watch.